Please be seated, please. This might be a treat. I was in New Orleans last week and got the Massachusetts family play, and this was one of the things that they played in the program was this wonderful rendition of music. Anyway, just a couple of announcements. I'm John Goldstein. I'm president of the club. Welcome to the record club today. I just want to say something about the church. The club doesn't meet here every week, so don't get confused, please. We're meeting here today so we could do the speech contest and our regular site. They're having a huge event today, so they couldn't expand to include us for this activity. So we're here today, and Grace Church is used 7 days a week from about 8 a.m. to 12 midnight every day. There's always some kind of a religious activity here, or a community activity, or an arts activity. So we do all kinds of stuff all the time. You probably see 4 bins out there. They're not garbage trash cans, right? The silver ones, the aluminum ones. Please don't put trash in those things. That is actually a project. Valentine's, it's called a Valentine's project for homeless youth, homeless children. And it's a project of some kids, elementary school kids in Evergreen, who wanted to collect toys for homeless children for birthdays and so on. So if you want to give to that, I know they will be happy. But don't put trash in the room. So the other thing is, because we're so heavily used, I just want to explain about the bathrooms. Yes, we do have bathrooms down the corridor to the right. Please use the men's room only. Okay, the men's room only. There's a lock on the door. If you go in there, if you don't want to share it with anybody, just use the lock. But the preschool uses the other room, and we don't want you to be messing that up, or vice versa. So with that, we can begin the Rotary meeting officially. And I just want to remind you, for those of you who don't know what Rotary is, it is a leadership organization. And we meet with local business leaders, community leaders, professional leaders, civic leaders, leaders, any kind of leader of the community is basically what we want to meet. And we do meet regularly every week on a Thursday. We do that to build friendships, and we believe that through friendships and by working together, we get a lot of things done in the community. So that's how we define ourselves as a Rotary Club. And the first order of business today is always the Pledge of Allegiance. And who would like to volunteer to do the pledge? How did the community? Well, maybe I should just tell you also, we are video recording this program today, so just so you know that. If you have any objections to that, then either close your eyes or leave the room. Anyway, let's continue with the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Please, everyone, stand up and join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberties and justice for all.
Thank you. Do we have any visiting Rotarians? No visiting Rotarians? I'm not going to introduce any of the other visitors yet today. I know we have them. We have a speech contest, and glad to have everybody here present for that. And certainly after, as we go in the program, Peter is in charge of the speech contest. She will speak to that. But before we get to the speech contest, I just want to set the mood a little bit and show you a short video. Got a bit and a half, you know? And I figure if a kid can do this, you can do it, right? Maybe. That's it, we get there. Well, that's the crack fest. We're not about the crack fest, right? But when we want to read, we need the time. Here we go.
Okay, let's go.
All right, go on, man. Over dramatic ball.
So that was just a kind of, if a kid can do that, we can do that, right? Don't you think so? I'm only 35, but do I still learn from things like that? So we're going to turn the program now over to Arpita for speech contest. Thank you. Let's have a round of applause just because she's doing this, right?
Makes a difference. For a high school student who works, it could be having $13.50 in your pocket or nothing. 5 minutes makes a difference. Bakers know well enough that taking out cookie dough from an oven 5 minutes early gives you cookie dough, and 5 minutes late gives you a disappointed stomach and less space in the garbage. 0.08 seconds makes a difference. It's the reason you all know the name Usain Bolt for the 100 meter race in the 2016 Olympics. But no one knows the second place runner, Justin Gatlin. But these differences are temporary. Money is spent, burnt foods are forgotten, records are beaten, and time moves on. Time moves on. This is something that I've had on my mind for a while now. A couple weeks ago, I received news that my great grandmother passed away. I was shocked. I didn't know how to deal with death, and I didn't really comprehend what it meant. Then I realized, never again would I see that loving smile that could brighten my world. Never again would I laugh at her constant jokes. Never again would I even hold her hand. I was not surprised when, at her funeral, hundreds attended. She embodied building goodwill and friendship, constantly showing love to almost everyone she met. For example, I was a mistake, a good one to be sure, but because my parents weren't married, my father's side of the family ignored us, excluded us, and pretended we didn't exist. Despite this, the first time my grandmother met my mother, she took her in with two welcoming arms, a hug, acceptance. She sent her off not only with the comfort and support that she provided, but also with the knitted blanket she had made just for her. At her funeral, I heard plenty of stories of these knitted blankets that she'd made for everyone, but one stood out. When she had lived in India, a pregnant woman moved next door, and being the friendly person that she was, she immediately went to go visit them, to welcome them into the community and give them the blanket. She never saw this woman again, but years later, she received a letter thanking her for her kindness. The woman described that she had been in an abusive relationship, but lived with it because she believed that's how life was. The love and gift shown to her by a random stranger showed to her that there was more than that, and she deserved better than the abuse she really received from her husband. So she left him, deciding to save her daughter from the abusive life she saw with him. My grandmother showed me that the biggest change you can make in this world, the most important change you can make in this world, is in the lives of others. Her small actions made a huge difference, providing confidence to a doubtful mother and saving a wife and a daughter from a life of abuse. This was a woman who faced the cruel poverty of the Great Depression. This was a woman who endured persecution and hate towards the Japanese during World War II. This was a woman who was left widowed and alone for the last 40 years of her life. But despite all this, she didn't reflect the bitter and cruel world that she grew up in, but rather spent her time showing the love and kindness she wished she had received. Time is important. How each one of us spends our time makes a difference. Believe it or not, many of us won't have 94 years. So every second is precious. Every hour, every minute, every second is precious. The question is not, will you make a difference? The answer is simple. Yes, you will. But the real question is, what difference will you make with the time you have? Thank you.
Thank you. this opportunity can be for them.
What do you want to be when you grow up? It's a question that much of today's youth are asked at an early age. They dream of becoming a doctor, a singer, an engineer, an astronaut. At this age, dreams are limitless, unbound to rationality. Some already know what they want to do in the future, seeming to already know their purpose in life. At my age, I can't help but ask, what about me? What's my purpose? Time is ticking. It's only a matter of time before the world moves on without you. Society doesn't care if you're too slow to find your purpose. Society doesn't care if you can't seem to find what sets your soul on fire. Society doesn't care if you can't find your passion. You're just another speck in a globe with billions of other people. What difference would you make? Were you destined to change the world? Be a catalyst for change? Now imagine being dropped on a road of uncertainty. No aspirations to guide you. Imagine being unequipped for what lies ahead. It's a big and scary world out there. Imagine being in a society where success is measured in money and material items rather than what's most important, your happiness. You're told time and time again that you only have one opportunity to make it right, that you're stuck with whatever you choose for the rest of your life. So if that's the case, what makes you come alive and will keep you wanting more? You're lost and unsure of what the future holds, but that's okay. It's okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to be lost. You'll find your purpose. These are words I wish I told myself when I stressed over my future. To the parents out there, I'm sure your children have gone through this conundrum. For the youth out there, I'm sure there have been times when you've been anxious or confused about your future. One of the chief concerns of today's youth is how we can make a difference in the things we do. When we think about how we can make a difference, our first instinct is to think, how can we make a difference in the world? What a lot of people tend to forget is that you can make a difference at a local level. Your schools, your communities, your workplace, your friends. Your actions don't have to make a direct change in the world, because the people that you change around you, the people that you inspire and uplift, the smiles that you bring, they create a ripple effect that will make a difference in the world. A story I would like to share related to this is that of a close friend of mine who graduated this past year. It had been an extremely stormy and windy day, and I had been feeling overwhelmed and at a really low point. I remembered it poured outside as I sat in my room. At my front door, I heard a knock and found my friend in the rain and wind with a care package in hand. She had biked almost 2 miles to my house through the storm to check up on me. At the end, she gave me a hug and a letter that I still keep to this day. To this day, I'm sure she has no clue how her small act of kindness has changed my appreciation for the smallest things. In relation to the Rotary four-way test, I'm sure she never wondered or asked herself if what she did for me would build goodwill and better friendships. Your small actions are not insignificant. If anything, they are more powerful than you might think. If she ever wondered if what she did build goodwill or better friendships, to that I say yes. More than anything, I want her to know that she strengthened our friendship and made a difference in my life. To end off, I'd like to ask, what do you want to be when you grow up? What's your purpose? Maybe my purpose in life isn't to change the world, but to make a difference in the lives of those who come my way. Thank you.
the video is not working. Actually, I had a video for the robotics project, which we are actually trying to establish in inside the Union High School District. We are setting up artificial intelligence clubs in different schools. We have contacted Evergreen High School, Silver Creek Valley High School, Overfield, and Andrew Perry. Couple of schools already have the club established this year. We are trying to raise funds so that we can give them the equipments to start working on it. Since they are people are here, if you have friends who are interested, you are interested in anything like this, you can get in touch with your advisors at each school or the whole schools. And if your school would like to actually, since I think maybe you are from not one of the four schools, so then in that case you can actually get in touch with us, and for the next year we can then try to set up a club over there. The main purpose of setting up these clubs is to basically advance the artificial intelligence robotics knowledge in East Edmonton High School District schools, so that we can actually get to as many people as possible. Thank you.
Cried those tears and I felt those feelings, I always knew that I could talk to my aunt. think of changing the world, we limit ourselves to only regarding the money or the actions. And although these contributions are important, what we fail to recognize is that the greatest difference is made in relationships. The teacher who believed in you, the family member who raised you, the friend who was there for you. The truth of making a difference and building goodwill is building friendships. But in a generation where all we have to do is press a like button to acknowledge somebody, and we walk with our heads down looking at our phones and forget about the meaning of having your chin up, looking someone in the eye, and going out of our way to build a relationship. That is not to say that sharing a message online or revolutionizing the entire industry is not making a difference. Small and large actions have an impact. But it is when we shift our perspective to the truth that making a difference is not just something we help, but rather someone we are building a connection of hope with, that we can make a momentous difference. Our actions should become rooted in the power of human connection. Thank you.
My role here is to make sure that the judges have time to think and figure out what they're doing here, make the scoring and so on, and keep everybody attentive. I'm not a very good stand-up comic, so I'm not telling jokes, but you're really laughing, so it must be all right at being a stand-up comic. That's good. So maybe what I could tell you something about is the church here, the Grace Church has been here over 50 years in this community, and people drive by it every day, and when you drive by something after a while, you just don't see it anymore. It's just on the road, it's on the road. But churches have always meant to have a role to help with human development, help with personal development, and in each decade, in each century, that role has been played out in different ways. Today, we are really very much committed to the idea of helping people to, as you've all talked about in your speeches today, finding purpose in life, getting a vision of what you want to do and how you go about that. We do a lot to encourage youth and kids. Of course, we start with the preschool, and from ages 2 to 6, they come here, when they have new students on Monday morning, the first day they're here, this. Crying and screaming because they want to come home with mommy and daddy. What are you doing with me here? On Friday, it's completely reversed. They cry, why are you taking me out of here? I want to stay with my friends. So, the little kids, that's their experience of just kind of learning to associate with other kids and people and knowing there are humans out there. We also have a lot of programs to help people develop their abilities. We're not born with talent. No one's born with talent. Whenever you see somebody who has talent, you say, man, that person's got talent. You ought to ask them, how did they get the talent? And they'll always tell you, especially if they get any kinds of great awards, any kind of first prize, anything. They'll always tell you the truth, at that moment. It's always a surprise. If you're listening, you hear it. They'll say, well, they thank all the people who supported them over the years so they could become the kind of person they have become. They have thanked their parents, their photographer, the school teachers, their friends, the people who stood behind them, and when they felt really discouraged, there's someone who encouraged them to continue going on. It's really, that's the most important thing, because you have to master something. You have to have a desire for it, of course, and then you have to master it by practice and doing it over and over again and trying things. You don't know what you don't know. And we're all faced with that all the time. It's like, well, I can't do that. But once you say it, you can't do it, you completely eliminate any opportunity or possibility of moving on to doing something. So we have what we call it's really to help people learn musical instruments. It's run by high school youth, it's run by junior high youth. It was their idea actually to do it. They're all accomplished musicians, but they want to share their skills and ability, what they've learned, with other people their own age and all ages actually. So great to see that kind of involvement. Then we have the Evergreen Valley Youth Orchestra meets here too. This orchestra was actually incorporated as a nonprofit by high school students. And they needed a place to practice. And so they came and asked here. I said, no, you couldn't do it here. We don't like music. We don't like youth. We don't want to help people. We don't do anything creative. You know? I said, come here. Of course you're welcome here. Glad to have you. So then we have, on top of that, we have a scout troop that's really, again, committed to helping people build their skills and abilities, confidence, self-confidence, and which they do so well, and it has a lot of Eagle Scouts because it really focuses on people going through the system and learning how to become the best they can be. But that's really what community organizations should be. That's what churches should be, just be helping people to grow and develop. Churches do not dispense answers to questions, contrary to many opinions. They really help you to, if they're really good church, they're gonna help you ask the right questions so you can get the answers to the context that you're in. They don't dispense them very well. Never have, never will done, never have done a good job at that. So, that's Grace Church. We're so glad we could hear you, if we could do this today, because it's a bit different for us. We do help a lot of school programs in town. They'll use this as their auditorium for their concerts for kids in the elementary schools and so on, private schools. Music recitals are held here, and even on a Sunday, I get to preach here as a pastor, so unusual. They squeeze me into the program. And there's a Rotary Club. You know, I became part of this Rotary Club because I saw how powerful it can be when people work together to improve their community. You come up with all kinds of ideas, and you can then work together on something that you can't do on your own. And one reason why we sponsor, the Rotary Club sponsors a speech competition, is to give people like you a chance to practice something. Because we all need practice in speaking. You don't know what you don't know. Am I ready, Abby?
Yeah.
Oh, I was just beginning too. I thought I had like 20 minutes to go.
Okay, we'll be coming our last but not least contestant, D. Continues walking, picking up these starfish and throwing them back into the water until a man approaches him who has been watching him from the distance. He goes up to this boy and he asks him, "What are you doing? Why are you wasting your time like this? There are probably thousands of starfish on this beach. How can you save them all?" Way past their limit,
And I'm sure all of you are familiar with someone in your lives who is like that. For me, it's my little sister. My little sister this year, she's taking 7 classes, and on top of that, she has outside classes and a job. She's only 15. How is this possible? It's not. Because one day, she finally had a mental breakdown. She didn't think that she could finish her homework, and so she wanted to ask my mom to give her the next day off of school. Obviously, my mom told her no. And when she realized that she couldn't convince my mom to let her skip the day of school, my sister, she was on her knees, and she was begging my mom to let her take the day off. She said, please, I can't finish my homework. There's way too much. Please let me take the day off. I overheard this argument, and so I went to my sister, and I told her, it's okay if you can't finish all of your homework. I'll help you. Just do as much as you can. That night, my sister was able to do all of her homework, and I only helped her finish part of it. There are so many people in this world, like that man on the beach, like my sister, who think that the only way they can make a difference is if they do a lot, if they can make a big difference, because small differences might as well be no difference at all. They look on that beach, they look at those thousands of starfish, and they lose hope because they tell themselves, I can't do that. I can't save all those thousands of starfish. What's the point of me trying? I could probably only save 20. That person over there, he can save 200, my 20 is nothing. Why should I try? But that mentality is way more common than you think it is, and it's more likely that this person over here who can save 200 starfish is probably looking across the beach and looking at that person and saying, why should I even bother? That person can save 2,000 starfish and I can only save 200. My 200 is nothing. Making a difference, people think that the only way you can ever make a difference is, as I stated before, by making a huge difference. But it's not always true. You can make a difference in someone's life. You can extend your hand to them, strengthen your friendship with them, and send goodwill by telling someone who you see is stressed and struggling, it's okay, you don't have to do everything. What you can do is fine. Because even people we look up to, like Mother Teresa, we know her for her goodwill and charity work, but even she can't do everything. And there is a quote from her that aligns with what I'm saying. If you can't feed 100 people, at least you fed one. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Let's give a huge round of applause for our 4 amazing participants. So in the meantime, judges will take a few minutes. So in the meantime, we would love to hear from Ruth Ashford from Contra.
Help yourself to more food.
Thank you. Sure. Okay. My name is Ruth Ashford. I'm a past president of this Rotary Club, and
Speech was just chair.
Yes, I was just asked to say a few words, and so you never know when you might ask. To say something, and so I'm going to hopefully say something that will leave a mark on you today, and hopefully in a positive way. I know that we all stand, at least I hope we do, in solidarity, I don't know, I can't even say it, with the children and with the teachers in Florida. So maybe I can say something just a little bit lighter. Despite the fact that that I do have a lifetime teaching credential in one of the states in the union, I never expected to see the day that teachers would be expected to know how to shoot a gun. Okay, I'm gonna tell you something about my Rotary experience, all right? Because once I was a teenager, once I was a child even, I was born in Oklahoma. My grandparents homesteaded, at least my grandfather did, homesteaded in what is now the state of Oklahoma. At the time, it was Oklahoma Territory. Oklahoma is one of the youngest states in the Union. Only Arizona, New Mexico, Alaska, and Hawaii entered the Union after Oklahoma did. So it was kind of the wild, wild west with white people and black people and Indians. And I grew up thinking everybody was part Indian. That was just the environment I grew up in. I also grew up at a time of segregation where I couldn't go to the movie theaters. I couldn't eat in restaurants. I almost got kicked out of an amusement park at one time because I was black. So that was my environment. Integration came along when I was in junior high school. One thing that I was reminded of once I became a Rotarian was that as a young person growing up in Oklahoma, I saw not only the discrimination, but I saw many things that I was curious about. And one of them was something that we know today as the Rotary Wheel. You can see it right there on the banner there, the Rotary Wheel with the spokes. I saw, and you will notice that as you're entering towns, you may see a sign saying, Kiwanis welcomes you, the Rotary Club meets here at such and such a time. I saw that Rotary Wheel, but living in a segregated society, I thought, well, gee, that has to be something for white people, because I knew nothing about it. But of course, times changed. I grew up and as an adult, I was vaguely aware of Rotary, and then I joined Rotary. And of course, the first thing I did when I went back to my hometown as a Rotarian was to visit the Rotary Club there. It's a small town, population of only about 30,000 people. So I visited the Rotary Club. And of course, they asked for visitors, or visiting Rotarians. So I stood up and I said, I was a visitor from the Rotary Club at the time, the Rotary Club of Willow Glen, and that I had gone to high school, Shawnee High School and undergraduate school in Oklahoma. And I said a few other things and I sat down. At the end of the meeting, several people rushed over to me and hugged me. And of course, I was the only black person in the room, the only female in the room, because there are Rotary Clubs like that to this day. And people were hugging me and I'm smiling and just thinking, who on earth are these people? One of the people turned out to have been my high school biology teacher. And I didn't think that he noticed me that much, you know, when I was there, because it was, my purpose was to stay out of trouble. You know, we all had to sit alphabetically, and because my maiden names begin with an S, I sat near the back of the room, but to study hard, of course to make my A's and try to be at the top of the class and that sort of thing. But he remembered me. And I had to go back, and after we talked a while, I did remember him. But I was really surprised at the impression as he talked that I made on him as a student. And so that just goes to show you never know who's watching you or what sort of impression you're making on them. About two other people that I spoke to that day who came up and spoke to me were people whose parents owned businesses that were segregated. And one of the Rotarians' father had owned all of the movie theaters in town that I wasn't allowed to go to. But they knew me because at the time, they were ahead of me in school, but I was under them. I was in the ninth grade and they were seniors in high school, but they still knew my name and they remembered me, and you know, freshmen, they remembered me. But it was just the greatest feeling to know that that things had kind of come full circle in a way, and to know that the world does change and that you should never you know, give up on yourself or give up on anyone else, because there's always room for improvement for all of us. Okay. That's what I have to say. Any questions about, I didn't get to talk to you about Oklahoma.
So now I would request all the judges and the students to introduce yourself. So, Greg, would you like to start?
I'm Greg Calkins, I'm a keeper. Sarah Calkins is my wife. This is one of the things I like to do every year. Volunteer, be a timekeeper. It's always inspirational to get those teachers and see our future.
East Side high school teacher and counselor. When I taught English for many years in East Side, I required my students every year, every student had to give 3 speeches, and they were petrified to do it. And they said, "Why do you do it?" And I said, "Because I still get nervous when I speak in front of people. The important thing is not your nerves, but knowing that you can get the job done. And you all proved that today. So whether you came in first or second, whatever, is almost totally immaterial, because the difference between one day and another is it's just that day. The important thing is that you're here, standing your ground and representing yourself with dignity. So I congratulate you."
sure how long the speech contest has been going on, but I know that many cities across this country, certainly here in the U.S., have a speech contest, and for high school students usually. And I have even read at one point that there are Rotary clubs in Australia who actually open up the speech contest to grammar schoolers and middle school age children. One thing that our Rotary Club does in an effort to get the word out to students like you is that we first do a poster. And we print up a poster, this little size, a poster, and it's typically on a bright color, like hot pink or green or yellow or something like that. And we post it on the wall, or we send it to all of the teachers in the Eastside Union High School District. And we ask the teachers to post it on their walls. Of course, that doesn't always happen. But for those of you who will be around next year, be sure to look for, you should see it in at least one or two of your classrooms, or even in the hallway, you know, when you see everything else on the wall, look for something. It'll be brightly colored. We try to get these announcements out before Christmas. And so that when you come back from the Christmas holiday, the posters are there. And that's to give you close to 6 to 8 weeks notice about it. So we certainly hope that we try our best. We have not been visiting the schools as much as we have in the past, and I'd like for us to get back to that, because that's a lot of fun, to go into the classrooms and to speak directly to the students and to answer their questions and to encourage them to apply for the speech contest. I've had a few surprises in the years that I've been involved with the speech contest. I know I go in and there's a room full of students, and of course I don't know any of them, and then my number is always at the bottom, usually at the bottom, and I speak to the students, I still don't know who they are, and I'm answering their questions and telling them about the rules, going over the rules with them, and informing them about the location of the speech contest, that sort of thing. So a few years back, there was a young man from Piedmont Hills High School. He was essentially a jock. He was a football player. That was, you know, he was going to, you know, join the majors and that sort of thing. He called me up and asked to be in the speech contest. There was room. I put him down. He did so well that year. Never done any public speaking before. He won at our club level, I believe, and then he lost. He made it up about two levels, because there are four levels of the speech contest. All right. The following year, I was at his school to speak to some of the classes about the speech contest, and I almost got thrown off campus by the vice principal, because he said he just couldn't let anybody come in from off the streets. And I said, I'm not just anybody from off the streets. I'm a Rotarian. And he said, well, you heard me. Get out. And he went storming off. And so I just went up to the desk, you know, and I asked one of the clerks there, I said, would you please page Justin Townsend for me? Because she paged him. He came out. Oh, hello, Mrs. Ash. How are you? Oh, is that the speech contest flyer? I said, yes. Okay, all right, thanks. And he was off. That year, he won the finals. He won at our club level, he won in the area, he won in the regional, and he won the district finals. So the potential is always there. It's always there. And that's a big surprise, and it's just a fun time of the year. It's my favorite time of the year in Rotary, is the time around the speech, the various levels of the speech contest. So thank you all for having the courage to pick that phone and to apply and to come out today. We really appreciate it. You've made our day. Thank you.
You heard Ruth speaking for a minute. district, and she was sort of through telepathy telling me, you know, this is where it starts, right, at the club level. The winner today goes on to the area contest, and today's first place winner gets $150. We'll announce it in just a minute. Gets $150. Goes on then to the area contest, and my age is creeping up. What's second place at the first place at the area?
Yeah.
I believe it's.
More importantly, you need to announce the date and the location of the area
Okay. That is right at the top of my brain right now. Where is the area and the date? Do we know anybody?
I know the location. I can't confirm the date. The location is going to be in the
Silicon Valley, where they meet on 4th Street.
4th Street in downtown San Jose.
That's the regional.
No, okay. Oh, that's the area.
All right.
No, I just wanted to be correct. Ruth is correct. The area is going to be in Mariani's. Mariani's restaurant and supported by the Santa Clara Rotary Club.
Yeah, it's Thursday, March 1st. Thursday, March 1st at Mariani's restaurant, Santa Clara.
Okay, so let's move along then. March 1st at Mariani's. The winner today will go, and then from there, there's the regional contest, and then from there, there's the district contest. The reason I'm mentioning this is all of you did such a great job in your speeches, and it was nice to see you. I see some winners, and you were all winners today, but I see our first place person today moving on. I want to let you know, whoever that first place winner is, you do not have to give the same speech. Hopefully you learn some things today after you see the judges' sheets. You are welcome when you're finished, everyone, to look at the judges' sheets. You know, you can see where you did well and where you maybe need some improvement. So those sheets will be made available. They'll be up here. You could look at them. And then, and if you want, I know people have their iPhones or something. They take pictures of them and they then study them to improve on their speech. At the next level, you do not have to give your same speech. Let's say today you heard someone say something that you really liked and it resonated with you. You could incorporate that into your new speech because you decided, I didn't like the way it came across. In other words, it's your time, you won the place, you get to go on. Okay, so I handled that. And now we have the checks. The participant stuff has been done. The only thing I did not do. The only thing I did not do, and I know it was done previously, the judges. Thank you, judges. You have some of the best judges I'm going to say we've ever had. They have a long record of experience, and they're very good. When I was looking at the judging, it was terrific as far as, and it was difficult. And we'd like to start by announcing the third place winner.
I was trying to get the letter because that's how everybody knows you so far. But the
name is here, and the name is Hadishi Zhu.
Externals in the world. So happy birthday, George, and anybody else.